All right, so let's get to business here, man. I got to be honest. This new album, Six, is my favorite album since Lights Out.
All right. I'm happy to hear that.
This album is real special for some reason. Like, it sounds real, like, I don't know. It's hard to explain. Like, it feels like a really special album when I listen to it. Like, it really hits you a little bit. It's dark.
I guess you can say that. it's like I think someone else asked that, and it's like the music is the music part is the party kind of, you know, and then the lyrics are the opposite many times, but this time it seems to be we kind of that feeling we got, you know, when we didn't know what to do anymore, whenever everything shut down and such, you know, we didn't know if it would have been the last live shows that we did, really, you know. So it was a little uphill for a while.
I do know, just based on talking to you in the past, is that you know, like, over the pandemic and whatnot, now you guys started writing during the pandemic, right?
Yeah, we did. We had a couple of ideas before, but it was just very, you know, it was still on the idea, kind of a very early stage for those two songs. But everything is pretty much written during the pandemic, and all the lyrics are as well.
One of the things I noticed, and even for myself as a writer, that I noticed this happened, was that during the pandemic, during the lockdown, it really made me, like, think a lot and kind of process where I was as a writer and as a musician. And like you said, I had no idea if this was going to be the last time I'd ever play in front of an audience or anything like that. And did that kind of process and that kind of thought process for you, that kind of influence the overall mood of the album?
Yeah, I think so. Most of all, lyric wise, and then I think I'm sure that's the way it is, and somehow it seemed I don't know. We as always, we didn't have a plan really on how or where to go, you know. We kind of just went along with what was there, you know, during that time. So it's a little melancholic, but I think it turned out pretty good. I mean, I always wanted to make a slower record like this, so I'm very happy about it.
One of the things that made me a Graveyard fan so long ago in the first place was that there was always this way of you guys playing that kind of touched on some of the darker subject matter, you know, lyrically. And like you, I liked how you described it earlier, is that, you know, some of the music was like the party and then the lyrics were kind of like, whoa, that's kind of dark. Like, it didn't match, you know?
Oh, yeah.
Where, like, this time, excuse me, is that it all kind of, like, lines up. And it's, you know, I think you said melancholy. That's a better description than just saying dark, because to me, it's not like a depressing record, but it is a very moody album. Like, it's the kind you can sit down and listen to each song and kind of absorb it and get something from it. And I also seemed to notice a change a little bit in the influence behind the writing. Like, I heard a lot more Doors than in previous albums.
Yeah, maybe I we didn't have the intention. I think whenever we released the second single, "Breathe In, Breathe Out," it was after that I understood that. Yeah, it sounds, especially maybe the end sounds, but a lot like the Doors, you know. And but there was no intentions to do that, really. It just happened, kind of. But it's I understand that, and it's as always, it's so hard to analyze your own stuff, you know. It's not always a good perspective. It's always hard when you're in the middle of it, kind of, you know, to have perspective on what kind of music or influences you really have sometimes, I feel like, you know, sometimes it feels like it's easier for, or maybe not easier, but it's more, it makes more sense if a listener just describes it, you know.
And that's kind of, and to me, that is the sign of truly great songs and great music, is that when you hear something in a song that the writer or the artist and the performer consciously didn't even try, like you weren't even consciously trying to like manifest a Doors song. You know, it's not like you went in, you're like, okay, we're going to totally copy a sound. But, you know, when we listen to music a lot, especially as musicians, it's hard to not have those influences come out sometimes, but you're not thinking about it. But so like, do you enjoy the fact that fans will hear something that maybe you didn't hear and you're like, oh, okay, yeah, like they're listening to the songs in a deeper way?
I think that's interesting, and it's you know, as you say, it's uplifting to hear something that you didn't expect to hear, kind of someone saying, you know. So it's I think it's great, you know, and we have been listening to so much music throughout the years, and you know, we probably, as you say, you don't know what your influences are sometimes. It's just in the back of your head somewhere. So yeah, it's always fun to hear other people talking about the music. You know?
And you know, like you said, I feel like when you're creating the songs, you're not thinking so much, or you're not overthinking it. It just comes out, and it's better to let the fans or the listeners like decide for themselves what they feel like you're trying to present them, as opposed to force feeding, like this sounds exactly like this band, or this sounds exactly like that band. Because with this album, like I feel like 6 albums in, I'd even say by the time you guys put out Lights Out, you have developed like what I call it, like the graveyard sound, where you kind of have your own identity and it's very distinct. Like, how does that feel to be a band like that, where in a time bands sound like other bands, but yet you have like developed your own signature sound?
Oh, thank you. I don't know. To me, it's a very, I mean, in these days, it's an honor to hear you say that, you know. But it always felt like it was there naturally from the start somehow, and then we haven't been noticing that change as much ourselves, I think. But because, you know, it's something about, I don't know what it is, but the way we play and the way we write, I think that dynamics are very important. So I think that's one of the reasons to why we have that sound, maybe, because you have to find a middle way, kind of, where you can just, you know, make changes with the sound without taking it down extremely much, or you know, you have to use your just use you know, I don't have a good way of explaining it, but to play, I think to play with your ears is the best way of creating your sound, you know, and not just do whatever everybody else is doing, maybe, you know.
I would think it also helps too that from that graveyard didn't settle on like, okay, this is what we're gonna sound like. And every album, you know, like, I mean, that's the thing, is like bands like, you know, I don't know, even more current bands like Uncle Acid, yeah, bands like that, where it's almost like they keep making the same record. When Six was coming out, I was talking to, you know, my best friend, and we were like, we have no idea what this album's gonna sound like, you know, because every album seems like not just growth, but that there's a change in direction sometimes, or that there's a change in mood. The fact that you're able to do that unconsciously is incredible. Do you ever worry that you're not like appealing to just one particular sound?
No, I mean, I agree, but you know, I don't know. It seems to be like there are bands that, I mean, great bands that has been doing pretty much the same album after album for 40 years or whatever, you know. And they have
like AC/DC.
Yeah, and you know, and they're great, you know, at that. And it seems like it just I mean, the crowd seems to love it anyway, and it's I think they're awesome, you know, too. But as you say, I feel like I think it has a lot to do with, you know, having fun playing your own songs. Mm-hmm. I think that's a big part of it too, you know, because I think we need that, you know, that different kind of moods in the live set as well. I think that makes it way more interesting, and also gives more space to, you know, improvise, or, you know, just take off for a little bit. You know, it makes it a lot more fun.
And, you know, even in the live setting too, I feel like with the various moods that you guys have with the songs, do you ever kind of feel like it gives you some more flexibility, like in a live setting where you're like, okay, this is a little more of a mellow audience, so we're going to kind of do the mellow songs, or like, you know, this is a balls out rock festival, so we're going to just hit them with all our hard songs.
Yeah. I mean, we've been talking about that, and because a lot of times we play, you know, metal festivals and all that, and it's great. But, and then we've been discussing, like, what do you think about it? Do you think they kind of need a break from it and hear some slower songs, or do you think they're just, you know, up for the harder ones, you know? But we never really figured it out, I feel like. But, you know, it's, I don't think we adjust so much, really, to what we think they want to hear. And that might be a good thing too, you know. We still keep mixing it up and try to have the different vibes in there. So I think that has been the way, or the recipe for us to do it, is just, you know, do whatever feels best in the moment, kind of, which is kind of both, you know, it can work out fine, or it can be, you know, a mess. You never know, you know. But it's part of the fun, I feel like.
I mean, the other thing too, and I love what you said about giving people a break, because do you know Jess and the Ancient Ones from Finland?
Yeah, I think you talked about it last time, maybe, or a couple of years ago or something.
Yes. And I remember when I was talking to the drummer from King Diamond's band, because they were out on the road with King Diamond at the time.
All right.
And I was asking him, I said, you know, how do you like having, you know, Jess and the Ancient Ones on the road? And one of the things he said was, you know, he goes, we usually play with a lot of loud, fast bands. And he goes, and it's a nice change to have something a little more mellow and melodic that gives people something new or something different to see live and to hear. Like, I would guess, based on what you're saying, like, that's kind of what you aim to do with Graveyard's material, is that you're like, okay, this is what we want to play, and if you like it, that's cool. If not, then, like you said, maybe it'll be a mess, or maybe people will just be like, wow, this is a nice break.
Yeah. I don't know. It's always hard, you know, or in the end, I guess we realize that it doesn't really matter if what we think they want to hear, you know. So they just, in the end, it's just, you know, to do whatever.
you have to play the music. And one of the things I like to always say is that, as to be honest, as musicians, like, we're selfish. And I don't mean that in a bad way, because we do this because we want to do it and we like it. And if you really have that integrity, or that, if you believe in your music enough, you're gonna believe in it and you're gonna play it regardless of the situation. Because I honestly feel like, at least with Graveyard, that Graveyard is one of those bands that it's almost impossible that if you guys are playing, that people won't stop what they're doing and go, "Wow, okay, this is different. This is cool." You know what I mean? Like, 'cause you guys are very commanding on stage, but you're not demanding.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I hope you're right. I mean, that's very nice words. But as I think, as you say, it's important to like what you do without thinking too much about, everything else. And if I think that if you just enjoy it enough, you can create something, that more people like.
One of the things you said earlier is that when you're writing material and you're recording, you're not so much thinking about like where it's going or what it's going to do. You're very much in the moment and kind of doing what you feel. So once the album was complete and you actually got to sit down and kind of listen to it, like, did you feel like that you had done something pretty special?
I've, as you say, it was during this process, it was more of a song by song, step by step kind of, and so it's always hard to get the full pictures or picture whenever you're almost done. So when we got the full album, I felt like, I got a good feeling, to be honest. I felt like we did something good. I feel like there's not many bands playing that kind of music right now. So it felt good, to be honest. And also a relief, to finally have it done.
And that was the interesting thing, was because, like, again, like, I remember talking to you like throughout the pandemic, and I remember you were telling me, like, that you guys, you were in the writing mode and that you were doing demos and things like that. And it almost felt like that it kind of hit you guys at a pretty appropriate time, because, you were off a touring cycle and you were going in to make an album anyway. But with the pandemic lasting so long, was there a point at all where you might have even been a little scared, thinking like, are we even going to be a band, after, through all, or after all this, if it does, or through it, if it doesn't end?
Definitely. And we, since we didn't, no one knew anything really, so it could, if it just, yeah, as you say, we didn't know if there would be a future for bands playing live at all, or and as you say, you it can be struggle enough just to keep things going, whenever it works just fine. But it's I think you're right about the timing, that it was pretty decent timing after all, and we the first part of why we didn't finish the deadlines or finish the record before the first couple of deadlines, it was partly because it took a lot of vibe, and at least for me, it slowed down the writing process. I didn't feel very I don't know why it just took a long time to finish the songs, you know. Whenever you sat down, and it wasn't the peak of the inspirational era, I feel like, for my part, but it was also a good thing in the end that it took a long time, or it doesn't really matter when you think about it. So it's all about the result, but it was a downwards period, and that's why, I guess, as you said, that's a big part to why the record sounds like it does. But we're, you know, happy about the result, and that's what counts, I guess. We're back. It feels good.
Well, I mean, 'cause again, as we as an artist, if you're not happy with the result, excuse me, it's hard to let it go out to the people, because if you let it go before you feel like you've done something comfortable with it or something truly great with it, then you're not going to feel good about it. So did the slower process of writing, do you feel like that maybe it even made the songs a little better because you didn't feel pushed or like demanded upon for a deadline or something like that?
I think it might have been good for the record, you know, because I mean, we were it was all the hard part, or the hardest part, I guess, during the recording of this record, was that we some of us had to work regular day jobs, and then we have kids, and we're divorced, so we just, you know, every second week we couldn't, you know, be in the studio. And then, you know, the flu came, and we took turn getting the flu, and, you know, everything was just really hard to plan, really. But it was so we whenever we were in the studio, we weren't, you know, laying around, you know, being lazy, but it was hard to plan everything, really.
The whole concept that so many bands kind of fell because of that. Like, what was it that came together for you guys and made you guys say, like, okay, we're gonna stick this out? Like, we have to stay together.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to tell, really, but I think that we all enjoy playing music so much, really, that's the main reason, and I think that even during, you know, not as good times, it's important to just to remember why you do things the way you do, you know, and it's of most often it has a reason. You have a reason to be where you are, you know, and I
Right.
feel like I don't know. I feel like music is needed, you know, and different kind of music is needed. So yeah, I believe that both our, you know, both the joy for music and the stubbornness made it happen. Yeah. I think so. It's hard to tell, but that's what I believe.
Well, so now the world is somewhat back to normal, you know,
Yeah.
like, and you guys have played some shows. Do you feel a different energy when you're playing shows now? Like, because I feel like a lot of times we take things for granted that, like, oh, we're always going to be able to tour. We're always going to be able to play shows. We're always going to be able to do this. Is there a different attitude to you guys now, when you're playing shows, like going into the shows?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I mean, it's as you say, it's very easy to get used to things and take it for granted, but yeah, that was a wake up call, you know, and realize that it's not obvious at all, and I feel like we especially the first tour we did with together with Cadaver in Europe after the pandemic. It
Yes.
was a very good feeling to be back on the stage and to somehow really take the moment in, you know, and reflect on the crowd's energy and all that stuff. You know, it's a beautiful thing when you think about it, and it's too easy to forget that, you know, it's special.
You know, when I started back going to some live shows last December, my whole attitude about going to shows completely changed because now I feel like every time I go to a show, in my mind, I go, this could be the last show I go to again, you know, if it happens again. And so as a fan, I'm feeling that. Are you feeling that from the fans themselves in general? Like that there's a different energy to them.
I think so, you know. It feels like and I guess that's a good thing, really, that, you know, people really everybody that's at that place really are there because they appreciate what's going on there. So it feels very, you can tell that it's positive vibes, and especially, I don't know if it's because of it's easier to focus on that now, but it's I think it feels it felt always felt great, but now it feels even better, you know.
Now, you guys did this tour with Kadavar, and I'll be honest, man, I was sitting at home jealous as hell because I was like, oh my God, man, that would like bring that tour over here, man. You know what I mean? Like, what a great, I mean, the lineup was really great. Now, how is the connection with them? And like, was there a little more of a sense of camaraderie between the two bands than there was on the previous tours?
I think it was, I mean, it was great, and they're all a bunch of great guys. But I don't know, we're a bunch of introverts in the graveyard, and I feel like it's easy to kind of just, you know, be, yeah, just be in your comfort zone whenever you feel like, yeah, because, you know, a lot of nights, or pretty much every night, you try to step outside of your comfort zone as you play music, and then you kind of get a little lazy in other situations. So we, a lot of times, we end up just hanging, you know, the same old guys, but we hung out with the Kadavar guys for a few times, and they are really laid back, you know, it was a very good tour for both bands, I think.
So you guys did a great tour. You guys had some really cool festival shows. Like, so when are you coming back to me?
I that's a good question, because we don't have a date set for a US tour yet, and I don't, I'm not sure why, but you know, hopefully I'll know in a very soon future, I hope, at least. But we'll definitely, you know, try to come over very soon, and to every other place as well, you know, as much as possible. And I think that's some kind of, you know, it's always healthy. You always hear people saying that, you know, you should always, you know, it might be, you know, never know if it's the last day, you know. So I appreciate everything, and that's kind of, that was a good reminder, as you say.
Yeah, it really was. It was very much an awakening of sorts. And so here's the deal, is that you guys have six albums now. Like, it must be getting harder and harder to make a set list for a show, you know? And how are you guys going about making a set list after six albums?
Yeah, as you say, it's not easier the more songs you have, but I don't, we just, you know, we since we have often we have a limited amount of time to play, especially festivals and such, and so it feels like it gets, you know, the set list can, or it's just fewer and fewer songs on there, really. But it's just that we have to, you know, pick some old ones away to make room for the new ones, and then, you know, just try to not forget songs from an entire album or so, you know, because people want to hear a little different music or from different periods, I suppose. But yeah, mostly we just feel, or we pick what's feels more most comfortable, I would say. And since it's, you know, it's always hard to be picking songs like from day to day. We had a for a very long time we used to change set list every night, but nowadays it's too much of a hassle when it's more records to do that. So, you know, we try to play a set for a little while, and then we change up and play another one, and, you know. But it's a lot of fun to play new songs as well, you know, to get some variety from the old live set. And you kind of have to be on your toes a little and wake up. So it's good for us, you know. We're getting old too, so we need to exercise a little.
It's getting harder to memorize lyrics,
Yeah,
you
definitely, yeah.
know? Because one of the things I also always noticed about graveyard shows is that even with the set list, there's always, you don't always play a song the same way twice. So, like last time you guys were touring here, you remember, like I saw you in Atlanta, and then I saw you in Asheville.
Yeah.
And even though the set list was the same, they felt completely like two different shows. And so, in some ways, do you feel like that by doing that, you get a little more of an opportunity to improvise on those songs or find new ways to play them?
Yeah, definitely. I yeah, you're right about that. It's when you feel comfortable with the songs, then you can start exploring them, you know, because otherwise I don't know, maybe someone else would do it, you know, immediately. But a lot of times I have to sometimes in the beginning, after making a record, I always try to stay to the, you know, how it should be played and how it was played at the on the record. But every time I feel like there is something, you know, taking off, as you say, and it's I don't know, it just you find a way that's more comfortable, or, you know, you find different ways that feels more interesting, or just improvise, as you say. It's always a gamble, kind of, but it's more fun, yeah.
Well, like you said earlier, it's either going to be really fucking awesome or it's going to be a hot
Yeah,
mess, man, you know? But that's the exciting thing about playing music, you know, is that especially with your own songs, you get to say things like, okay, you know what? We're going to take a little bit of a chance here, because one of the things I also noticed in your set list is that the longer, you know, time after an album, those songs live start to kind of change, you know, and like even back to, you know, was it as the years passed, it's like you those songs like that kind of had a little jam in the middle where you kind of made a change and inserted something that wasn't on the
Oh,
album, and that makes it fun for you, because you're like, okay, I get to do something new with this song as opposed to playing it the same way every tour.
yeah, definitely, yeah. It keeps it interesting, you know, in somehow. And I don't know if some people, or a lot of people, maybe, or it's just different, but maybe some people would like it to be exactly like it is, you know, on the records, and some people kind of thinks it's cool that it's not exactly the same way. But, you know, as long as they can hear what song it is, I feel like it should be all right.
But you know, and that's the exciting part, you know, like for someone like me who's, you know, a fan of improvisational music, you know, like as you know, like I'm a big Deadhead. And so to me, seeing a band live kind of stretch a song out, you know, and try something different, it to me is exciting because it shows that you're not just trapped into playing a song the same way.
Oh, that's cool. Yeah, I mean, I appreciate it too. Way. I mean, when a band does something different and just, you know, it's makes it a lot more interesting and alive in some way. I enjoy that too.
I mean, because, you know, at least in my opinion, if you want to, if I want to hear a band sound just like the album, I'll just listen to the album, you know? Like, that's why what I was saying earlier is that what was so incredible was that, you know, seeing you guys two nights in a row, you did the same set list, but I was not bored. I didn't feel like, oh my God, they're playing this just like they played last night. It's like night from night, the energy kind of seemed like you guys feed off of the audience when you're playing live.
We might do. I mean, yeah, it's always like you always get affected on the reaction from the crowd. I feel like if they're really happy, you get very happy too, you know. It's always contagious that, you know, but it's very obvious when you're on stage, really, that you get, you get energy from each other. It's pretty cool.
So this is the second album with Oscar on drums. It's the third album with Truls back on bass guitar. That change really seems to, you know, kind of shift the graveyard sound a little bit, but into a direction that almost sounded like it was a significant growth.
All
Did
right.
you feel that way yourself, what with the guys coming in?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think you know, I think everybody has been great to the band, but this, as you say, Truls and Oscar, they are really talented guys, and I feel like we in every way we listen better to each other, you know, both musically and as a group. So I think that's I think that's really important for the music, and I feel like we've never been better at what we do than we are right now. So yeah, they've been or they are doing a great job. They're amazing musicians. So.
Now, see, I feel the same exact way because when I hear a band, especially when there's a change in lineup, to me, it's going to go one of two ways. It's either going to be a significant growth because you're working with someone new, or it's going to go the other way and it's not going to be as good. And you're going to go, oh, if they would have kept those guys, they would get better. You know, so in some ways, do you feel like the growth of the band was because of Truls and Oscar coming in? Because they both have distinct sounds that are different from the people they took over for.
Yeah, they do. I mean, they definitely have a big part of how we, I mean, it's half the band, so of course they have a big impact on how we sound. But it's always, like you say, it's always a change. Like everything can change. Everything about a band can change if you switch one of them out a lot of times. As you say, it's like it's very distinct. I don't know. Sometimes you just. You can just you don't even know that there's a new member, but you can definitely tell that, okay, there's it's still great, but it's very different, you know. Oscar, both Oscar and Truls are so talented. It has just made everything a little better, maybe, you know. As you say, it's an improvement.
I feel like the graveyard sound changed, but for the better. And like when I, you know, the first album I heard with Oscar, The innocence, no, not Innocence and Day. Well, oh shit, I can't believe I'm spacing on this. It was what was the piece? Like I noticed that there kind of came this a little bit of a heavier sound, almost like a Bill Ward drumming from like Black Sabbath. But with that, he had that same subtlety and ability to play very soft, but that like Axl had. But man, when you guys kicked it up a notch, boy, he really just let it go.
Especially you can tell in that song, "Please Don't." I feel like he's, 'cause he's really he can he swings a lot, like he's swinging. He has a very groovy way of playing drums, I feel like, and then he can also take it down like super, very minimalistic if he wants to, and yeah, he's just he has a great groove.
I mean, like to go from like on the Peace album, to go from like Cold Love to Delmanic, that's such a, I mean, those are like two completely different styles, and I feel like that to me was where it became significant that like, wow, okay, Graveyard is completely opened up to be able to be more dynamic.
Oh, that's cool. That's awesome that you say that. It's yeah, that's it's the I think it's when I or I don't know. I don't listen to as much, or I don't look up as much new music as I should, but nowadays, but I think that's something that I miss. When I watch bands live, sometimes the dynamic and the different, it's a lot of times it's full on for a whole show, or it's the opposite or whatever, but I kind of like the contrasts, live. So I feel like both Oscar and Truls is yeah, it was the perfect choices in that. In that downwards moment that we had, and it's never fun to switch out members, but it was the best solution we could ever, come up with.
One of the things that I noticed also, which is pretty fucking mind-blowing, is that you guys have now been out of long enough that Graveyard has influenced younger people as bands, like because I remember the first time you and I met was when Hisingen Blues came out, and like now, four albums later, you've got these, younger bands coming out that were like, oh, Graveyard's a big influence on us. Like, how does that feel to think that you just went from being a kind of new band at one point to now being an influential band?
No, it feels very good to have been able to influence other people to play music. That's a great reward, I feel like, for the job we've done. So I get very happy and honored by that. But also it's kind of unreal, I still feel like the 20-year-old boy trying to play guitar. So it's yeah, unreal, and very, I get very happy, from that, because it means that yeah, if it means something to someone else, it's worth it,
Oh, absolutely. Because, like I said, and of course, in my mind, I'm like, I'm not that old. And also, I'm like, well, shit, man, I'm 50 now. You know what I mean? And I'm like, so, which means I've been listening to Graveyard since I was 40, and I'm like, 10 years is a long time, which is incredible because in a time where, like I said, when bands were coming out and sounding identical to each other or making the same style of music, it's like you guys did something right that connected with people enough to say, wow, Graveyard is a band that is, is influential. to somebody enough to say, like, either I want to form a band or to say, that's the sound. That's the sound we want.
All right. That's awesome.
What do you guys have plans, say, like from now until there's this potential US tour? Like, do you have shows lined up to play more, or?
I mean, we're doing a bunch of shows this fall in Sweden and Scandinavia, and then in the spring we have been talking about South Africa, but that's not official yet. So we have some different options, but we still haven't gotten a decision. So from New Year's we don't really know exactly what's going to happen, which is a little, it's a little late kind of, but everything has been kind of late so far. So it's we'll definitely get a somehow or get a schedule going sometime soon.
It was so great talking to you as always. And
Yeah, likewise, man. Likewise.
like I said, man, congratulations on making such a great album. And I can't wait to hear these songs live at some point. So you guys did good, man.
Oh, thank you, man. Thank you.
Well, thanks again for doing this.
Oh, thank you for having me. And let's keep in touch, and hopefully we get a tour not too far off in the US. It's always good talking to you.
Soul will walk for free.